from the JAMA Network. This is JAMA Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinion featured in JAMA.
Hello, and welcome to our listeners around the world. You're listening to JAMA Author Interviews, and thanks for joining us. I'm Dr. Gregory Curfman, the executive editor of JAMA. I'm speaking today with Dr. Michael Lipnick and Dr. Philip Bicker, both of whom are professors of anesthesia at UCSF. And they are co-authors on a recent perspective article now published at jamanetwork.org, which is entitled Pulse Oximetry and Skin Pigmentation, New Guidance from the FDA. Welcome to the podcast, Drs. Lipnick and Bicker.
It's great to be with you.
To start us off, Dr. Bicker, can you give our listeners a brief description of pulse oximetry and the mechanism by which it works?
In simplest terms, you can think about oximeters as devices that measure the color of blood. Blood changes colors as oxygen levels vary, from a bright red when there's lots of oxygen bound to hemoglobin to more of a rust or brown color when there is less oxygen. And it's a favorite game among anesthesiologists, and especially in our testing lab, to try to guess the saturation of a blood sample based on the color. Turns out that the human eye is not very good at it. But fortunately, oximeters can quantify the color changes in blood by shining at least two wavelengths of light through the tissue. And these are red and infrared wavelengths. The devices are not interested in venous blood, so effectively mathematically subtract out the non-pulsatile signal from venous blood and thereby determine the saturation of hemoglobin with oxygen. This requires some mathematical formulas and calibration. And in theory, this idea is relatively straightforward, but in practice, it's more complex. And this is the reason that each new pulse oximeter intended for clinical use has to be verified in healthy adult subjects during induced hypoxemia. And this makes sure that the math, hardware, and software of the device yields a reliable oxygen saturation.
Can you talk a little about this process?
There are two leading regulatory frameworks for pulse oximeters. The first is the U.S. Food and Drug Administration that provides recommendations for pulse oximeter performance. And this is also known as the 510K clearance pathway. The second is the International Organization for Standardization Pulse Oximeter Standard. It's also known as ISO 80601. These are very lengthy technical documents, but in a nutshell, pulse oximeters intended for medical use are recommended to be tested in healthy adults during controlled induced hypoxemia studies. Participants breathe through a mouthpiece, and the fraction of inspired oxygen is lowered by increasing nitrogen. CO2 is also bled into the circuit to avoid lightheadedness from hypocapnia. And during the test, we target multiple plateaus of oxygenation ranging from 99% down to 70%. Once the participant reaches a stable oxygen level, a blood sample is drawn from an arterial line in a radial artery and measured on a co-oximeter, also known as a blood gas analyzer, to report the functional oxygen saturation. And that, for us, is the gold standard. The functional saturation from the co-oximeter is compared to the saturation reading from the pulse oximeter, and statistical methods are applied to either calibrate the oximeter or assess the performance of the device.
I wonder if you could briefly discuss how might darker skin pigmentation affect the function of oximeters, and what is the mechanism here?
Well, we don't know completely. There are several theories. Very few have been published, and we suspect that there are several with intellectual property protection that are being kept private for now. Some of the most common theories essentially postulate that melanin in the skin impacts either the absorption characteristics of light passing through the tissue or impacts the overall signal-to-noise ratio in such a manner that results in the saturation being different from the actual arterial saturation. This is an effect which we refer to as bias. And most of the time, the bias is in the positive direction, so that melanin in the skin or tissues tends to make the pulse oximeter read too high. Hence the concern about overestimating the saturation and missing the diagnosis of clinically significant hypoxemia.
For our clinician listeners, can you give us an idea of just how significant the clinical problem is of oximeter dysfunction in relation to skin pigmentation? Is this a very consistent problem?
Yes, and it's the crux of the issue. Anytime we have health and healthcare disparities linked to a medical intervention, that's a big problem. Based on the data published thus far, the problem requires serious attention. You know, during COVID, our hypoxia lab was asked time and again, is it only 1% or 2% difference that's troubling the oximeters? And is that really a big deal? This was coming from hospital systems, global aid donors, and our clinician colleagues. And the answer turns out to be nuanced. On the one hand, it is true that a 1% to 2% difference in oxygen saturation is not likely to result in markedly different pathophysiologic consequences like end organ damage or mortality. And this was the prevailing feeling among many pulse oximeter research from the 1980s until now. And it's probably part of the reason the problem did not receive more attention. So while the physiologic consequences of the SpO2 bias may in most cases be minimal, it is also true that small differences could result in patients receiving different care because of this difference in care, that they have different outcomes based on the color of their skin. This was historically underappreciated, but multiple studies during COVID for the first time highlighted that this indeed may be happening. And it is not hard to wonder if the bias was worse in people with lightly pigmented skin, would this problem have been taken more seriously long ago?
The FDA has just come out with new guidance regarding oximeters to try to address this problem. And I wonder if you could briefly discuss the new FDA guidance, what it says, and what its implications are.
In January of this year, FDA released a draft of its new guidance for medical pulse oximeters with a focus on improving equitable performance across skin colors. The last update to the guidance was in 2013, and the new 2025 guidance draft has some key changes. Probably the biggest change involves increasing the size of study cohorts used for device performance verification in the controlled desaturation studies that we do, the ones we talked about earlier. From the current enrollment of about 10 to 12 subjects, up to 150 subjects. So a dramatic increase in the size of the studies required for performance evaluations and regulatory clearance. Another big change is better methods for ensuring the diversity of skin pigment in the study cohort. Previously, the small cohorts of 10 to 12 people were recommended to have at least two people with dark skin pigment, but the guidance did not say how skin pigment was to be measured or what constitutes light and dark. So the common practice in the industry was to use the visual analog scales with 6 to 10 colors ranging from light to dark and to rate study participants subjectively. And using scales which have many problems, not the least of which is operator bias of the person assigning the colors. In the new 2025 draft guidance, FDA recommends measuring skin color in two ways. The first is using the Monk Skin Tone Scale, which is the only standardized 10-color scale that was designed specifically with diversity of human skin color in mind. And the second is using a spectrophotometer to actually measure the color of the skin. It's like if you went to the hardware store to match a paint color. Color can be quantified. There are a number of devices out there that can do this for skin. And while there is no complete consensus on the method, a widely used and validated approach is the use of what's called the ITA, which is an established surrogate for melanin. Using these methods, a new guidance recommends ensuring the proportion of participants that are light, medium, and dark is more equally distributed than the prior guidance, where only 2 of 10 study participants were recommended to be darkly pigmented. So it encompasses the full range of human skin pigmentation. In addition, there are several less noticeable but important changes in the new draft. This includes recommending reporting of consecutive participants to avoid cherry picking of only participants in who the devices perform well. Also, there is a new recommendation to collect more data from pediatric population in the clinical environment using convenience sampling, because obviously it's not ethical to conduct controlled desaturation studies in children. There are new statistical tests and metrics that are recommended to reduce the chances that a poor performing device makes it to market. Notably, the draft is open to public comment until March 10th. But even once finalized, it is technically not a regulation or legally enforceable, though most of the manufacturers, at least in the U.S., are anticipated to follow because they would like their devices to be cleared when they submit their applications to the FDA. We view that overall, these are very positive steps, and the FDA should be commended for raising the bar. That said, the bar was previously pretty close to the floor, and there is a lot more that can be done. And there are several elements in the draft guidance that, if refined, would strengthen the document and provide better health equity. And included in that list are objective use of the ITA is now added for some of the statistical analysis and to define the darkest half of the darkly pigmented cohort. But it leaves the door open for a device to reach the market with a significant portion of the darkly pigmented cohort not being truly dark. It's an easy fix and one that the ISO is likely going to make to include the monk skin tone scale, but rely on the ITA and other objective measures to define light and dark. And a more complex matter is of sample size. While the sample size of 10 was widely acknowledged as too small, the optimal size is not a straightforward power calculation. There's no question that the sample should be bigger and needs to be as big as needed to ensure equitable device performance. But the reality is a study size of 150 are not necessarily going to demonstrate equitable performance, and an adaptive study design is likely viable. And the FDA needs to provide more guidance and flexibility on that. If that's not done, there are some major potential problems that could arise, including device market rapidly shrinking, prices increasing, access to devices decreasing, especially in low-resource, low-income countries. And even with these large cohorts, there still may be devices reaching the market that in reality no better than those under the old guidance. And this brings us to our last point, and that is for the devices to reach market, they're tested in healthy adults in a controlled lab setting. Performance in patients in the real world is different. Some have argued for more real-world clinical testing of devices prior to reaching the market, but a more pragmatic approach may be to try to make lab studies better mimic the real world. And there are certainly ways to do that. So that's an open opportunity to test devices under more challenging situations that may be similar to some of the challenges that are faced in the real world. And the new guidance has lots of recommendations on better communication and performance to clinicians. But if those communications are buried in fine print in the product manual, and fundamentally the diversity of cohorts is uncertain, and the translation of lab performance to the real-world performance in patients is uncertain, then the impact of the newly updated guidance may be limited.
Dr. Lipnick, I wonder if we could turn to you, and I wonder if you could tell us what are the next steps in addressing this problem with oximeters?
Thanks, Dr. Curfman. You know, I think a big next step is going to be validation. The new draft guidance from the FDA, like Dr. Bickler was saying, it's a great step forward. There are a lot of really positive changes there, but there's a lot of uncertainty also, uncertainty in how this is going to impact the market. We need to make sure that the implementation of these new regulatory frameworks actually translates into more equitable care, better performing devices, while also preserving access to oximetry, which is a major global health challenge.
Dr. Lipnick, do you have any final thoughts or lessons learned for our listeners?
One final comment. A lot of folks have suggested, well, why don't we just introduce a correction factor for a certain device manufacturer or a certain skin pigment type? And I would urge caution with this. A lot of the retrospective studies, as Dr. Bickler said, found positive bias in the 1% to 2% range, meaning the oximeters tended to overestimate the true saturation, making a patient potentially appear better than they really are. But it's important to note that some studies have shown negative bias, and some studies are showing that devices may have little or no bias. So The upshot is all devices perform quite differently, and we don't yet understand why this is, but it does suggest that universally adding a correction factor for patients with dark skin pigment or for a certain manufacturer of device may not be the best approach. I think understanding imperfection in pulse oximetry and avoiding the use of absolute SpO2 cutoffs as the primary factor that clinicians are using to decide who gets care and who does not get care may be much more important. It is underappreciated, but a good approach while we're waiting for more data on this matter. A lot of large studies are coming out soon. Hopefully we'll shed light on what clinicians should be doing at the bedside or home care users should be doing to optimize safety and health equity. But I would encourage the listeners, clinicians, the scientific community to pay close attention. I think we're going to learn a lot in the coming months, but the story is just beginning to be told, and we're just beginning to understand how to optimize patient care using pulse oximeters, which at the end of the day are an essential device and clinicians should continue to use them, but perhaps with a slightly different lens than we have in the past.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Bickler and Dr. Lipnick, for this very interesting discussion, a very important clinical issue that we'll be following very closely as time goes forward. I'm Dr. Gregory Curfman. I've been speaking with Dr. Philip Bickler and Dr. Michael Lipnick about the effect of skin pigmentation on the function of pulse oximeters. You can find a link to their JAMA article in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow and Shelley Steffens at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at JAMANetworkAudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. And thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.